بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وبه نستعين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. I would like to welcome you all to our Microbiology Made Easy series. And in today's lecture, I'll be talking about the mode of action of antibiotics and the mechanisms of antibiotic resistance. Please don't forget to share this lecture with your friend and colleagues in order to obtain the rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Before we go deeply into this topic, which is antibiotics, I'm going to give you two definitions which I feel that they are important and that you have to know them before we go deeper and deeper into the antibiotics. The first definition is the definition of antimicrobial agents. So what is the meaning of antimicrobial agents? Antimicrobial agents, they are chemical substances with the capability of killing or inhibiting the growth of microorganisms. These microorganisms could be bacterial, could be fungal, could be viral, could be parasites. Now, these antimicrobial agents could be natural products, for example, extracted from plants, or it could be synthetic chemicals. The second definition is the definition of antibiotics. Antibiotics, it's a Latin word or Greek word. And the word anti, it means against, as I'm pointing at, and bios means life. So antibiotic in definitions, it means anti-life. So it means anti-life, but not anti-human life. No, it's antibacterial life. Now I'm bringing you back to some history of antibiotics. All of us, we know the famous scientist Sir Alexander Fleming. You can see his picture here. I'm pointing at him with my laser pointer. Sir Alexander Fleming, in the year 1928, he observed that when he left Staphylococcus aureus isolates on agar. You see here, this is the Fleming petri dish or Fleming famous agar. I'm going to get it with my laser pointer. So this is the Fleming agar. And what he did is he forgot and he left this agar on the bench over the weekend. And then when he came back, he found that there was a contamination or growth of a fungi, we call it Penicillium nutatum. I'm pointing at it with my laser pointer. You can see here the Penicillium nutatum, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. And what he notes that the area in the agar surrounding the Penicillium nutatum, which is a common mold, that there is no bacteria. However, far away from the mold or fungi, Penicillium nutatum, far away, there is a growth of Staphylococcus aureus. I'm pointing at Staphylococcus aureus in Fleming petri dish with my laser pointer. So you can see this area, there is no bacterial growth. So what he hypothesized that this fungi or penicillin are producing a chemical that, or an agent, that this agent has the capability to kill Staphylococcus aureus. And because of his discovery, he got Nobel Prize. And you can see his picture on the famous Time magazine. After that, two scientists in the year 1939 and in the year 1944 by the name Sleeman and Alpert, both of them, they are American microbiologists. These two scientists isolated penicillin and streptomycin and a number of other antibiotics from this mold or fungi. Now we are looking at classification of antibiotics. Antibiotics can be classified based on the three bases. The first classification of antibiotic is based on the mechanism of action. The second classification of antibiotic is based on their spectrum of activity. And the third classification of antibiotic, as I'm pointing at, is based on their mode of action. Now we are going to discuss in details within the next few slides within this lecture the classification of antibiotics on the basis of mechanism of action. As stated in the previous slide, that the classification of antibiotic are based on three different categories. The first one is classification based on their mechanism of action. In this regard, antibiotic can be classified into antibiotic which will inhibit the bacterial cell wall synthesis. We call them cell wall synthesis inhibitors. For example, like penicillin, cephalosporin, and vancomycin. So what that means? It means that penicillin, cephalosporin, and vancomycin, as an antibiotic, they kill the bacterial cell by inhibiting the bacterial cell wall synthesis. Another example of antibiotics which will kill the bacteria by producing an inhibitors of beta-lactamase. These antibiotics will include polymycin and bacitracin. We have another group of antibiotic which will inhibit the bacterial protein synthesis. We call them protein synthesis inhibitors. This antibiotic will be targeting the bacterial ribosomes. And this antibiotic will include antibiotic which will inhibit the 30S ribosomal subunit of the bacterial cell. And these antibiotics will include aminoglycosides like gentamicin and tetracycline. What you see here in this slide and in this diagram which I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, the chemical structure of the tetracycline. Also, under the antibiotic which will inhibit the protein synthesis of the bacteria, we have antibiotic which will inhibit the 50S ribosomal subunit of the bacterial, and these will include macrolides, chloramphenicol, and clindamycin. So all of these three different antibiotics, macrolides, chloramphenicol, and clindamycin, kill the bacterial cell by inhibiting the 50S ribosomal subunit of the bacteria. Then we have another group of antibiotic which kill the bacterial cells by inhibiting the DNA synthesis of the bacterial cell. We call them DNA synthesis inhibitors. For example, or an example of the DNA synthesis inhibitors antibiotics, we have fluoroquinolines and metronidazole. Then we have another group of antibiotics which kill the bacterial cells by inhibiting the RNA synthesis of the bacteria. An example of this RNA synthesis inhibitor antibiotics, we have rifampin. Also, we have another group of antibiotics which inhibit the mycolic acid synthesis of the bacterial cells with special reference to Mycobacterium tuberculosis. An example of mycolic acid synthesis inhibitors antibiotic, we have isoniazid. This is the chemical structure of the isoniazid. I'm going to get it with my laser pointer. Then we have another group of antibiotics. We call them folic acid synthesis inhibitors. These antibiotics like sulfonamide and trimethoprim, they kill the bacteria by inhibiting the folic acid synthesis of the bacterial cell. In the previous slide, we have talked about classification of antibiotic based on mechanism of their action. And then I have stated that there is a group of antibiotics like penicillin, cephalosporin, and vancomycin. Their mechanism of action in the killing of bacteria is by inhibiting the bacterial cell wall synthesis. Before I will explain to you how these antibiotics like penicillin, cephalosporin, and vancomycin are killing the or inhibiting the bacterial cell wall synthesis, in the next slide I'm going to explain to you how the bacteria sensitize its cell wall or its peptidoglycan cell wall. And then after that, I'm going to explain to you on how these antibiotics are interfering with different steps in the bacterial cell wall synthesis. Before I explain to you the bacterial cell wall synthesis, just I'm going to have a quick revision in what we have covered previously regarding the peptidoglycan of gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria. If we look at the peptidoglycan of gram-positive bacteria, you can see it consists of N-acetyl myrimeric acid, which is the NAM, which you can see here in green color. I'm pointing at it with my laser pointer. And then we have N-acetyl glucosamine, or the NAG, which you see here in red color, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. And then, as I have mentioned previously, that the first layer of the peptidoglycan, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, are attached with the other layer or row of the peptidoglycan by beta-glycine cross-link, which I'm pointing at them with my laser pointer. And as I mentioned, that the beta-glycine cross-link, we call them beta-glycine because consists of 5-glycine. These beta-glycine are attached into the peptide bond. This peptide bond consists of L-alanine, D-glutamate, L-lysine, and D-alanine. You can see this peptide bond, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. You can see the peptide bond, which made of the 4 amino acids, which I'm pointing at them with my laser pointer, in the first layer of the peptidoglycan. And then you can see the 4 amino acids, L-alanine, D-glutamine, and L-lysine, D-alanine, which I'm pointing at them with the laser pointer, in the second row or layer of the peptidoglycan. And you can see that these two peptide bond, L-alanine, or these 4 amino acids, are linked together with the beta-glycine cross-link. For gram-negative peptidoglycan, the same thing, we have the NAM in green and the NAG in red, which I'm pointing at it with my laser pointer. And then we have these 4 amino acids, L-alanine, D-glutamate. And then in the gram-negative peptidoglycan, as I mentioned previously, we have L-diaminopenimelic acid. However, in gram-positive peptidoglycan, we have L-lysine. And then the last amino acid in this peptide bond, we have the D-alanine. This is in the first layer of the peptidoglycan. The second layer of the peptidoglycan as well, we have these four, or the peptide bond attached to the NAM. And then you can see that these peptide bonds are cross-linked with what we call a direct cross-link. This is in gram-negative peptidoglycan. Now, after having this revision regarding the structure of the peptidoglycan, now I can explain to you the mechanism of the bacterial cell wall synthesis. This diagram summarizes the synthesis of the bacterial cell wall and the action of antibiotics, which will inhibit the bacterial cell wall synthesis. So let's start with the first step. In this diagram, which is step number 1, which I'm pointing at with my red dot. Here what we have is, the first step is the activation of the NAM and the NAG. You see it here, this is the NAM, okay, and then the NAG. How the NAM and the NAG get activated? The NAM and the NAG get activated by binding of UDP to the NAM and the NAG. So here you see this is UDP. I'm making a circle around UDP. This UDP stands for uridine nucleotide diphosphate. So when the UDP bind to the NAM and when the UBD bind to the NAG, the NAM and the NAG will get activated. So the first step is activation of the NAM and the NAG by binding of the UDP to it. You can see here, using my red dot, you can see the UDP binding to the NAG. And here UDP is binding to the NAM. So this is the first step in the bacterial cell wall synthesis. The second step is the binding of, or the synthesis of, the what we call them linking peptides. You see it here, we have the NAM. You remember what I've mentioned in the previous slide, that we have four amino acids, or R, which we call them D-alanine, DAP, D-glutamine, and L-alanine, that these four amino acids are attached to the NAM. So you can see here, as I'm drawing with my red pen, you see the synthesis of the four amino acids. These four amino acids, number 1, 2, 3, and 4. Then these newly synthesized linking peptide are attached to the NAM. Okay? So then we have NAM attached to it, UDP. So then the NAM got activated. Then we have the synthesis of the linking pentapeptides. Okay? Pentapeptides. Now, these four peptides, we call them PEP. So PEP here in green color, this is an abbreviation of, this is an abbreviation of, you say the name here, PEP is an abbreviation of this PEP. This is abbreviation of pentapeptide, PEP. So, bacterial cell wall synthesis starts with the activation of the NAM and the NAG. Here we have the NAM, I'm pointing it with my laser pointer, and we have the NAG. The NAM and the NAG get activated by binding of the UDP to both of them. So here you see UDP, I'm pointing it with my laser pointer, we call it UDP, stands for uridine nucleotide diphosphate. UDP is binding to the NAM, as I'm pointing with my laser pointer, you see the binding. And then as well, UDP or another UDP is binding to the NAG. So then the NAM and the NAG got activated. The second step is the synthesis of the pentapeptide. Says number 2, synthesis of the linking pentapeptide. Pentapeptide is a shortage of PEP. You see it here in green color? This is the PEP. This is the PEP. Okay? Then what will happen is, the NAM, with its linking pentapeptides, or the PEB, okay, will be transferred from the UDP, okay, carrier, into another carrier. We call it BBB. I'm showing it to you here in this diagram. So then what will happen after that? The NAM will be transferred, the PEB, or the linking pentapeptides, will transfer to a new carrier. We call it BBB, which I'm drawing a red circle around it. You see this one? This is BBB. BBB. BBB stands for back to phenol phosphate. So this is a carrier. Okay, so then the NAM, BEB, NAM, which I'm pointing at now, NAM, this NAM, plus BEB, which is this one, okay, are transferred to a new carrier, which we call it BPP. Okay? Now, what will happen is, at this stage, you remember we have here, a NAC got activated, isn't it? By binding of the UDP to it. As I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. Remember, you have the NAC here. As I'm pointing with my laser pointer, the NAC got activated when the UDP bound to it. Then what will happen? This activated NAC will go and will join the NAM. As I'm pointing with my laser pointer. You see now? Follow the laser, the red laser pointer. You can see here the NAC UDP are moving in the direction of the laser pointer, my laser pointer, and you see it here. You follow the red black arrow, and then you can see here that the NAC, which I'm going to get with my laser pointer, are joining the NAM. Are joining the NAM. Okay? Then to form the NAM and the NAG. For the NAG and the NAM link. Don't forget that the NAM is attached to what? To BPP or pectophenol phosphate, which I'm circling at it with my laser pointer. Okay? Then what will happen is, then this BPP or the pectophenol phosphate, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, will carry NAM and the NAG across the bacterial membrane. You see this bacterial membrane in a green color? I'm pointing at it with my laser pointer. You see this is the bacterial membrane. So then the BPP will carry both NAM and the NAG, and the penta peptides will carry them where? To the outside surface where the peptide glycan exists. Let's point it with my pen. I point it with my pen now. So here, this is the combination. You see here, this is the NAM, NAG, and the penta peptide in green. So this is the penta peptide. This is penta peptide in green color. Wait, I got it with my red arrow. So this is the beta peptide or PEP linked to the NAM, and the NAM is linked to the NAG. So this is NAG, and this is NAM. NAG and NAM are linked together, and then we have the PEP attached to the NAM. Okay? Then what will happen is the pectophenol phosphate will transfer the NAM, NAG, and the penta peptides will transfer to where? Across the membrane. This is the bacterial membrane. This one. In the green color. This one. In the green color. This is the membrane. You see it here. This is here. I'm drawing a red circle around it. Then what will happen is the PPP will transfer NAM, NAG, and the penta peptides across the membrane into where? Into the outer surface where the peptide glycan is present. You see it here. Okay? So this is the existing peptide glycan. This is the one. You remember the structure of the peptide glycan as I have shown in the previous slide? We have the NAG attached to the... As I'm working with my laser pointer, as I described in the previous slide, we have the NAG attached to the NAM. And then, to the NAM attached the penta peptide in green color, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. And I have said previously that the penta peptide are made of the four amino acids. This is in one layer of the peptide glycan. As I'm pointing with my laser pointer, in the other layer of the peptide glycan, as I'm pointing with my laser pointer, you can see that the NAG attached to the NAM. And then the NAM attached to the NAM is the PEP or the penta peptide, which is in green color. I'm going to get my laser pointer. And then what you can see here, more importantly, that the penta peptide in one layer of the peptidoglycan. So I'm drawing a circle around it. Okay, this is the first layer. This is layer number one. This is layer number two of the peptidoglycan. This is number two. Okay, so then the BEB or the benta or the benta peptide, which is this one, in one layer, layer number one. Okay, this is layer number one, is attached to the BEB in layer number two. This is the second BEB. This is the second BEB. They're attached to each other with what? With bentaglycine. This is the one. You see it here? This is the bentaglycine, blue arrow. This is another bentaglycine, which is holding the two BEB together. This is another bentaglycine. Okay? So let's go back into what we have said previously for the bacterial cell wall synthesis. And quickly, we have the NAM get activated when UDB attached to it. So we have the NAM, as I'm pointing out with my laser pointer. Once UDB attached to it, NAM will get activated. The same thing for the NAG. NAG will get activated when UDB attached to it, as I'm pointing with my laser pointer. You can see the NAG attached to it is UDB. This will be followed by the synthesis of the benta, or the synthesis of the linking benta peptide, or we call it PEB. I'm pointing at PEB with my laser pointer. You can see PEB in green color. And PEB are made of four amino acids, as I have described previously in the last, on the previous slide. And as I mentioned, that the PEB, after it's synthesized, it will be attached to the NAM. Then what will happen after this stage? The NAM, okay, will be attached to the NAM BEB, the NAM plus the benta peptide will be attached to a new carrier. We call it BPP, which is back to phenolphosphate. I'm pointing at BPP with my laser pointer. And then during this step, the NAG will move, as I mentioned, following this black arrow and following my laser pointer, will move, and it will, you see the NAG here, will join the NAM. And then the BBB, the PPP, or the back-to-phenolphosphate, will carry NAM, NAG, and the benta peptide, will carry them across the green-colored membrane, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. This is the bacterial plasma membrane. The BPP will carry NAM, NAG, and the benta peptides across the plasma membrane to go to where? To go to the existing peptidoglycan on the outer surface, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. And then this newly synthesized NAM, NAG, and PEP, or the benta glycine, they will do what? Or the benta peptide, they will join the existing chain or layer of the peptidoglycan. So let's draw that. Okay, so what we have here is, let's select a nice color. So what we have here, you see it here? We have a newly sensitized NAM, a newly sensitized NAG, okay? And NAG and the NAM are attached with each other. And don't forget, the benta peptide in green color, which is this one, are attached to the NAM. And this is the NAM. This the NAG, NAM, and the PEP will do what? They will join the existing. They will join the existing. This is the existing NAM, NAG, benta peptide. I'm pointing at them with my laser pointer. So this is the existing NAM, NAG, benta peptide. What will join to it? The newly synthesized NAG, NAM, PEP. They are joining with what? With the benta glycine linker, which is this one. You see it here? This is the, I'm going to get it with my pen. You see the joining here? Okay? So then, the PEP, or the pentapeptide side chain, are cross-linked with the release of the terminal alanine, and then this will result of the linking of the NAM, PEP, newly synthesized one, with the existing NAM pentapeptide through the pentaglycine cross-linking, which is this one. Okay? And then more NAM pentapeptide will be synthesized, and then it will join the existing pentaglycine, as I'm making the drawing with this purple circle. And then the synthesis of the peptide glycan will continue in this direction of the R which I have drawn down. So this is a summary of the bacterial cell wall synthesis. Now, if we will go back to the story of antibiotics, you can see here that I will show you now. Let's remove this drawing. Okay, so you can see here that the synthesis, step number two, okay, the synthesis of the linking pentapeptides can be blocked by antimicrobial agent. We call it cycloserine. This is cycloserine. This is the one. So cycloserine will block the synthesis of the PEP or the pentapeptide. So these pentapeptide, I'm drawing a circle around it, are blocked by cycloserine antibiotic. Okay? Now, you remember what we said is that after the NAG joined the NAM, you remember what we said previously? You see the NAG, I'm pointing it with my laser pointer. You see the NAG here joining the NAM. Of course, the pentapeptide are attached to the NAM. And as I mentioned previously, that the bactophenol phosphate or the BPP will carry NAG, NAM, and the pentapeptide. They will carry them across the membrane to the outer surface where the peptide glycan layer exists. So what will happen is we'll have another antimicrobial agent. We call it bacitracine. I'm pointing at bacitracine with my laser pointer. You see here, bacitracine. What's the function of the bacitracine? It will block the bactophenol phosphate. It will block the bactophenol phosphate. So what that means? The bacitracine will inhibit the bactophenol phosphate from transferring NAM, NAG, and the pentapeptide across the membrane. So it will interfere with the cell wall synthesis. Okay? Now, here in step number four, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, you remember the repeat unit is carried. You remember what we said is that the BPP, okay, you remember the bactophenol phosphate. What will happen is the vancomycin, the function of the vancomycin will block the attachment of NAM-NAG to the existing peptidoglycan chain. Okay? Also, you remember what I have said, that we have then, as I'm pointing at my laser pointer, we have NAG, NAM, and then we have PEP attached to it, as I'm pointing with my laser pointer. And then I said that we have cross-linking. You see the beta-glycine cross-linking, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. Okay? So, the mode of action of penicillin, it will block this cross-linking between the PEP in one chain, or chain number one, or the peptidoglycan chain number one, with the second peptidoglycan by blocking this beta-glycine. Okay? This is the mode of action of penicillin. So you can see that different antibiotics are interfering with the bacterial cell wall synthesis at different stages. For example, as I mentioned previously, cycloserine will inhibit the synthesis of the FD beta peptide. Also, what I have said, that the BPP, or tobactophenol phosphate, which carry the NAG, NAM, and the PEP through the plasma membrane to the outer surface, are blocked by bacitracine. So you can see antimicrobial agent or antibiotics will be interfering with the bacterial cell wall synthesis at different stages of the synthesis of the peptidoglycan of the bacterial cell. This is the diagram which I have described in the previous slide regarding the synthesis of bacterial cell wall, and just to show you a bigger diagram in order without any writing on it, so that's just for purpose of the clarification and for viewing the diagram without any handwritings on it. Before describing the mode of action of antibiotic like penicillin, I need to explain to you in this diagram how the, what we call it, penicillin binding protein, which is this one, bind the two strands of the peptidoglycan together. So what we have here is, in dark green, which is this one, we have the NAM. So this is the NAM. Okay, this is the NAM, and this is the NAG, bright green. I'm going to get it with the red arrow. Okay, then as I mentioned previously, we have the beta, we have the beta peptide, which is these ones are made of these amino acids, are attached to the NAM. You see this? These are the beta peptide. Okay? Beta peptide. These ones. Okay? Then we have, you remember the beta glycine? This one? This is the beta, the beta glycine, as I have showed it to you previously. Just to remove this one with the arrow. So I'll show you where is the beta glycine. This is the, in yellow color, this is the beta glycine. So you can see them here. The red ball is alanine. You see it here, this is alanine. Alanine. The blue one is D-glutamine. Green one is L-lysine. The yellow color is the beta glycine. And then we have the NAM, dark green, and the NAG, bright green. Okay, so this is what we see in one strand of the peptidoglycan layer. So what is the function of the penicillin binding protein, this one? What's the function of penicillin binding protein? Penicillin binding protein, it has something we call it reactive site. You see it here? This is the reactive site. You see it here, this purple dot in the penicillin binding protein. Okay, this is, we call it reactive site. So what we have, this one, you know, look at my laser pointer, the gray one, this is the penicillin binding protein. It contains purple dot, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. We call it reactive serine, reactive serine. Now, how this penicillin binding protein will bring the two strands, if we may so, of the peptidoglycan together. So what will happen is, what will happen? You see it here, step number two, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. You see the penicillin binding protein in gray color. You can see the active site of the penicillin binding protein in purple color, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. I will draw a circle around it. You see it here? The purple color, I'm drawing a red circle around it. This purple color, this is the reactive serine. So the reactive serine will bind to the second alanine in the pentapeptide. You remember we said the pentapeptide, the second one here. You remember the pentapeptide, this one? I'm drawing with my blue pen. You see it here? This is the pentapeptide. The second one is made, the red one, the red color pole. You see it here? This one is made of alanine. You see it here? So what will happen is the reactive serine in purple color, okay, the reactive serine, which is this one, the reactive serine, this one in purple color, will bind to the second alanine in the pentapeptide. So you see here, as I'm working with my laser pointer, we have the penicillin binding protein in gray color. You have the reactive serine in purple color, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, is binding to the second alanine, which is the red ball. The first alanine will go out. You see, follow the black arrow. You see the black arrow, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. The first alanine will go out. And the reactive serine will bind to the second alanine, which is the second red ball. You see it here? Okay. So this is, we have, you see here in this diagram, this is the first alanine. I'm drawing a circle around it now. Okay, and this is the second alanine, the second red ball. You see it here? Okay, then, so what I'm trying to say is that the reactive serine, which is this one, will bind to the second alanine. So I'm pointing at with my green arrow. This one will go out, the first alanine. You see it here? The first alanine will go out. I'm circling it around it with my green pen. And then the reactive serine in the penicillin binding protein is binding to the second alanine. Okay? So, okay, this is happens in the one strand of the peptidoglycan or one layer of the peptidoglycan. Then what will happen is what is shown in third step. So in the third step, what we have here, we have the NAM. So this is the NAM. See my red arrow, this is the NAM. What's bound to the NAM? We have D5, you see them here? We have, sorry, this peptide. We have four peptide now. Why? Because the first peptide, you remember, went out. So we are left only with four peptides. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. The first one is red ball, green ball, yellow ball, and then the red ball again. Okay, then what will happen is the alanine, as I'm pointing with my laser pointer, you see the alanine, the second alanine, I'm pointing with my laser pointer, will bind to the reactive serine in the penicillin binding protein in gray color, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, okay? So this is happening in one strand. This is the strand which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. So now we are describing step 3. Then what will happen is, another strand, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, you see the other strand? The other strand contain what? Contain NAG, bright green, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, and NAG, which is dark green, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. And you can see that this NAM, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, attached to it is the four, remember, peptides. Attached to it is the pentapeptides or the five peptides. And then don't forget that we have the pentaglycine in yellow color. The pentaglycine in yellow color. Remember the beta-glycine? This one. I'm drawing a circle around it. This is the beta-glycine in yellow color. This one. Okay? So then what will happen is, this penicillin-binding protein, inside it, you see this hole inside the penicillin-binding protein in gray color? The bentapeptide will go inside the hole. You see it here? As I'm pointing out with my red arrow, it goes inside. Okay? As these five bentapeptides go inside the penicillin-binding protein, then the beta-glycine, this one, you see it here? Okay? Will come and link or cross-link the bentapeptide in the first strand of the peptidoglycan, or they are linked with the second strand of the peptidoglycan. So what you will see then, you see it here, you see the penicillin binding protein, this one, this is the penicillin binding protein in gray color, all of this one, and then you can see the beta-glycine. I am drawing a circle around it in red color. You see the beta-glycine in yellow color, and I have drawn a red circle around it. It's joining or cross-linking between the beta-peptides or T-peptides. You see it here? So this is cross-linking. This is the cross-linking. As I'm pointing out with my red arrow. So this will result in what? This will result in the cross-linking between the beta peptide of the first layer of the peptidoglycan. This is number one. This is the first layer. And this is the second layer. Okay? And then you can see the penicillin binding protein in gray color. I'm drawing a blue circle around it. You see it in gray color, the penicillin binding protein. It joined the beta peptide from the first strand, number one, with the beta peptide from of the second peptidoglycan strand, number two. This is cross-linking happening through the beta-glycine in yellow color. So this is the role of the penicillin binding protein in joining or in linking or cross-linking the beta-glycine in one strand or strand number one with the beta-peptide of the second strand of the peptidoglycan layer. So this is the cross-linking as you see it here. Now, if you follow my, you see here, you can see the cross-linking, the beta-glycine cross-linking between the beta-peptide. So this is the beta-peptide one. It's the first this is the beta-peptide in the first layer of the peptidoglycan number one. And this is the beta-peptide, I'm drawing a blue circle around it, in the second layer of the peptidoglycan. And you can see the glycine cross-linking. You see it here? You see it here? I'm drawing a blue circle around it. You can see the yellow beta-glycine cross-linking the two beta-peptides. Okay? So then after that, what will happen is the penicillin binding protein, you see it here, which I'm drawing a blue circle around, will leave. After the penicillin binding protein finished its job of bringing together or between, or after the penicillin binding protein will cross-link the beta peptides of the two strands, if we can say so, or layers of the peptidoglycan, after it finishes its job, it will leave the as I pointed out with my arrow. You see it here, the penicillin binding protein is going away after completing the cross-linking between the two peptidoglycan layer. Okay. Now, in the previous slide, I have explained to you the role of action of penicillin binding a protein and bringing together the two chains of the peptidoglycan, and how the penicillin binding a protein can create cross-linking between the two chains through the beta-glycine. Okay, now what you see here in this diagram is the mode of action of antibiotic, which we call it penicillin. Penicillin are made, you see here in this diagram, this is the chemical structure of penicillin. It contains something we call it, which I'm drawing a circle around it, we call it beta-lactam ring. You see, this is the beta-lactam, this square is the beta-lactam ring. Okay, so how penicillin will inhibit the bacterial cell wall cross-linking? You see it here in this diagram. So what we have is, this is the penicillin binding protein, which I have explained in the previous slide. Okay, I remember what I have said, that this penicillin binding protein, it has an active serine, which is this one, and this active serine will bind to, you remember, it will bind first to the second alanine, and the first alanine will go out, you see it here, and then this penicillin binding protein will create cross-linking of these two chains. So this is the first chain or layer of the, and this is the second one. And you can see here the penicillin binding protein, I'm drawing a circle around it, are cross-linking the beta-glycine in yellow color. You see the beta-glycine? This is the beta-glycine cross-linking, drawing a red circle around it. This is the beta-glycine. So this is, you can see here how the, as I explained in the previous slide, how the penicillin binding protein brought together the two chain or the two layers of the peptidoglycan. However, penicillin, you see here, this is the penicillin in orange color. I'm drawing a red circle around it. So this is the penicillin as an antibiotic. What will penicillin will do? Penicillin, you see it here, will come and will bind to the serine active site. You see the penicillin here? This one? Okay. It will bind to the purple dot or the serine active site in the penicillin binding protein. I'm drawing a red circle around the serine active site in the penicillin binding protein in gray color. So then what will happen is, you see it here, the penicillin will go and will bind to the penicillin, or to the, sorry, the serine active site in the penicillin binding protein. You see it here? You see here the binding of the penicillin as an antibiotic to the penicillin binding protein, or to be more precise, the binding of the penicillin to the serine active site in the penicillin binding protein. So then what will happen? After the penicillin will bind to the serine reactive site in the penicillin binding protein, then the penicillin will open. You see the opening? The penicillin at the beginning, you see it here? The red arrow? The penicillin is looking like this. Like number nine in Arabic. Like what I'm drawing here. But then you see it here, this ring of the penicillin, which we call the beta-lactam ring, it will open. It will become like this, as shown in this diagram. You see it here? You see here? The opening? You see the opening of the? So the number 9 in Arabic of the penicillin, like open, it changed to number 4. You see it here? I'm drawing a red circle around it. So then what will happen is, after the binding of the penicillin to the penicillin binding protein, or to be precise, after the binding of the penicillin to the serine active site of the penicillin binding protein, then the penicillin cannot perform, the penicillin binding protein cannot perform its job of the cross-linking of the two, of the cross-linking between the beta peptides of the peptidoglycan layers. So then this cross-linking is not going to happen. You see it here? No cross-linking. No cross-linking. This is going to be stopped. No cross-linking. So then what will happen is then the bacterial cell wall synthesis will be incomplete. Why? Because there is no cross-linking, because the penicillin binding protein cannot cross-link the two layers of the peptidoglycan. Why? Because the penicillin binding protein cannot do its job. Why? Because the penicillin bound to the penicillin binding protein and stopped the penicillin binding protein from cross-linking of the through the beta-glycine between the penta peptides of the two layers of the peptidoglycan. And this is how the penicillin will interfere with the bacterial cell wall synthesis. Here, I'm going to explain to you the mode of action of another antibiotic, which is trimetoprim and sulfonamides. These drugs interfere, or antibiotics interfere with the folic acid synthesis. The folic acid synthesis usually it starts with the para-aminobenzoic acid plus pitridine. Then the para-aminobenzoic acid plus the pitridine will give us, or it will convert into dihydropetroic acid. Under the influence of enzyme, we call it dihydropetroisynthase. Then the dihydropetroic acid will be converted into the dihydrofolic acid. Dihydrofolic acid will change to tetrahydrofolic acid. And this tetrahydrofolic acid helps in the synthesis of the purine and pyrimidine, which are very important for the bacterial DNA. Tetrahydrofolic acid, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, will give us purine and pyrimidine under the influence of enzyme we call it dihydrofolate reductase. Now, the first drug, which we call it sulfonamide, okay, it will inhibit the enzyme, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, the enzyme which we call it dihydropetroisynthase. So the sulfonamide will inhibit the dihydropetroisynthase. So it means what? It means that the dihydropetroisynthase cannot change the para-aminobenzoic acid plus the pitridine into the dihydropetroic acid. So this means that it will result in the interference of the synthesis of purine and pyrimidine. So this is the mode of action of sulfonamide, as I'm pointing at my laser pointer. However, the other antimicrobial agent, which is trimetoprim, okay, it will inhibit another enzyme, which we call it dihydrofolate reductase. This enzyme, which is dihydrofolate reductase, the bacteria will need to change the tetrahydrofolic acid into purine and pyrimidine. However, the trimetoprim will inhibit this enzyme, which we call it the dihydrofolate reductase. So then this will inhibit the synthesis of the purine and the pyrimidine. So you can see here that another mode of action of the bacteria, another mode of action of the antibiotic like trimetoprim and sulfonamide, as they, both of them are interfering with the folic acid synthesis. And I've showed you or explained to you previously how these two antimicrobial agents interfere with the folic acid synthesis, because sulfonamide will inhibit the enzyme dihydropetroisynthase, and the trimetoprim inhibit another enzyme which we call it dihydrofolate reductase, and both of these enzymes are needed for the folic acid synthesis within the bacterial cell. This video explain to you the mechanism of action of antibiotics, and this is the link to the video in the YouTube. This diagram summarizes the classification of antibiotic on the basis of mechanism of action. For example, as I have mentioned previously, we have antibiotics like vancomycin, penicillin, and cephalosporins, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. Their mode of action, that they will inhibit the cell wall synthesis of the bacterial cell. So this is the bacterial cell. This bacterial cell wall, as I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, in orange color. Okay, this bacterial cell wall. Gray color is the plasma membrane. Blue color, which I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, is bacterial cytoplasm. And this is the nucleoid or the bacterial chromosome, which is bacterial DNA. So as I mentioned, vancomycin, penicillin, cephalosporins, they inhibit bacterial cell wall synthesis. Another one, which is the polymyxins, inhibit the cell membrane synthesis. Another antibiotic, which is quinolones, inhibit DNA gyrase or gyrase. Rifampin inhibit RNA polymerase of the bacteria. Tetracycline and streptomycins inhibit the bacterial protein synthesis by inhibiting the ribosomal 30S of the bacterial cell. And then we have erythromycin and chloramphenicol, which I'm putting out with my laser pointer, inhibit the protein synthesis by inhibiting the or interfering with the 50S ribosomal or ribosome of the bacterial cell. Another diagram, what you can see here, the different antibiotic. Here we have antibiotics that interfere with the cell wall synthesis. We call them cell wall synthesis inhibitor. We have the beta-lactams, cephalosporins, carbamazepines, and glycopeptides. All of these ones are interfere with the, so the beta-lactams, cephalosporins, and carbamazepines, and glycopeptides, they are interfering with the bacterial cell wall synthesis. Another antimicrobial agent, we have polymyxins. As I mentioned previously, it will disrupt the bacterial cell membrane. You remember, as I'm going to get with my laser pointer, sulfonamides and trimethoprim, as I have mentioned previously, they interfere with the folic acid synthesis of the bacterial cell or inhibit folic acid synthesis of the bacterial cell. Here we have a group of antibiotics which will inhibit the translation. We call them translation inhibitors. For example, like aminoglycosides, tetracyclines, chloramphenicol, oxazolidone, and macrolides. Then we have another antimicrobial agent, which is rifamycins. It will inhibit the transcription, or we call it transcription inhibitors. However, for example, as I mentioned previously, aminoglycosides with tetracycline, chloramphenicol, and oxazolidones, and macrolides, they are inhibitor of translation. However, rifamycins are transcription inhibitors. And then, as I mentioned previously, quinolones, they are DNA synthesis inhibitors. So they are killing the bacterial cells by inhibiting its DNA synthesis. You remember what we have said in the previous slide, the classification of antibiotics. We said that the first classification are based on their mode of action. And we have finished with that. Now we are moving into the second classification of antibiotic, which is on the basis of the spectrum activity. We have broad spectrum antibiotics. What's the meaning of broad spectrum antibiotics? It means that broad spectrum antibiotics, it can act against both gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria. However, short spectrum or narrow spectrum antibiotics, they are only effective against a specific family of bacteria. An example of broad spectrum antibiotics, we have amoxicillin, tetracycline, cephalosporin, chloramphenicol, and erythromycin. And an example of the short spectrum antibiotics like penicillin, cloxacillin, vancomycin, bacitracin, and floxacillin. This diagram shows the chemical structure of the penicillin and the cephalosporin, and you can see what we call it, the beta-lactam ring. This is the beta-lactam ring in penicillin and the beta-lactam ring in the cephalosporin. The third classification of antibiotic, the antibiotic are classified on the basis of their mode of action. On the basis of their mode of action, antibiotic can be classified into bacteriostatic. What's the meaning of bacteriostatic? It means that antibiotic which will inhibit the growth and the multiplication of the bacteria. However, bactericidal, it means that the antibiotic which kill the bacteria. An example of the bacteriostatic antibiotics which will stop the growth or the replication of bacteria like tetracycline, chloramphenicol, erythromycin, and lincomycin. An example of bactericidal antibiotics, which means that antibiotic that kill bacteria like cephalosporin, penicillin, erythromycin, aminoglycosides, and cotrimoxazole. So this is the classification of bacteria on the basis of its mode or of their mode of action. Now we are going to describe an important part of today's lecture, which is the mechanism of antibiotic resistance. The bacteria can become resistant to antibiotic due to intrinsic or natural factors, or the bacteria can become resistant to antibiotic due to as a result of acquired, or what we call them, genetic methods. Genetic methods could be chromosomal methods like mutations and extra chromosomal like a plasmid. So now in the next few slides, I'm going to explain to you the intrinsic or natural mechanism of antibiotic resistant in bacterial cells. Then after that, we move into the acquired and the genetic methods as a mechanism of antibiotic resistance of bacterial cell. As stated in the previous slide regarding the mechanism of antibiotic resistance, we have intrinsic resistance and we have acquired resistance. Intrinsic resistance or intrinsic bacterial resistance to antibiotic include absence of target, low affinity target, low permeability, and efflux mechanisms. Acquired bacterial resistance, we divided into two components. The first one is a mutation, and this mutation will result in the modification of the target. And then the second part of the acquired bacterial resistance to antibiotic, as I pointed out with my laser pointer, is the added gene or gene transfer by conjugation or transduction. And this will include the transfer of gene from one bacteria to another, can lead to an activation of the antibiotic, can lead to the modification of the target in which the antibiotic will bind to, or can lead to increase of the efflux mechanism. Efflux mechanism, as I'm going to explain in much more detail later, it means that the antibiotic will get into the bacterial cell and then it will be pumped out from the bacterial cell or kicked out from the bacterial cell in mechanism. We call it efflux mechanism. I'm going to explain to you in the next few slides all of these mechanisms. For example, like the absence of a target, low affinity for the target, low permeability, and efflux mechanisms. I'm going to describe them in much more detail in the next slides within this lecture. In this diagram describing the mechanism of entry of antibiotic, which I'm drawing a green circle around it. So this is the antibiotic. And then the antibiotic will enter the bacterial cell through a porin or opening or channels in the bacterial cell wall. So this, we call it porin channel. So then what will happen is the antibiotic, which I'm pointing at with my green arrow, the antibiotic will enter into the inside the bacterial cells on through porin or opening channels in the bacterial cell wall. You can follow the green line which I'm drawing now. You can see now we are going through the antibiotic is going through the porin or the opening channels in the cell wall, and then after that through this porin, the antibiotic will go into the inside the bacterial cell. So you can see here, you can see the antibiotic. I'm drawing a black circle around it, the antibiotic inside the bacterial cell. Don't forget that this is the bacterial cell wall. So the bacterial cell wall contain these channels or porin channels or opening. These porin or channels through it, the antibiotic will go into the inside the bacterial cell. And where this porine or opening located? They are located in the bacterial cell wall. So here you can see now, if you follow the black arrow, you can see the antibiotic entered the bacterial cell through the porine or the opening channels on the bacterial cell wall. So this is how antibiotic enter into the bacterial cell. So this is in the antibiotic sensitive bacteria, in antibiotic sensitive bacteria. What you see here in this diagram, this is the antibiotic which appears as a red ball, which I am pointing at with my laser pointer. So this is the antibiotic. And then, as I mentioned in the previous slide, in the normal situation, this antibiotic will enter into the inside of the bacteria through these porine or opening channels in the bacterial cell wall. If you follow the green line which I'm drawing now, you can see that antibiotic is entered into the inside of the cell. So this is what happens in the normal situation. However, due to the natural and intrinsic causes, you remember what I have said previously, the mechanism of antibiotic resistance. I have stated that antibiotic resistance in bacteria can be attributed to natural intrinsic causes or into acquired. So one of the natural intrinsic causes of antibiotic resistance in bacteria is what we call it decreased uptake of antibiotic by the bacterial cell. So how the bacteria will decrease the permeability to antibiotic? What will happen is, what will happen as you see here, you can see here, so which I'm pointing at, drawing a green circle. So this is what happened, as I mentioned in the previous slide, in the normal situation. So you have the porine, and then through these porine or opening channels, the antibiotic will get into the inside of the cell. However, due to natural intrinsic reasons, you find that there will be a change in the shape of the porine or the opening in the bacterial cell wall. So you see here, I'm drawing a circle around a new channel or a new porine, a channel in the bacterial cell wall. So you can see that the shape of the porine channel on the bacterial cell wall changed from the normal round, which is this one, into square. I'm drawing, you see it here, as I'm drawing with my black pen. So what you see is, due to the change in the shape of the porine or the opening in the bacterial cell wall, so then the antibiotic cannot get into the inside the bacterial cell. Why? Because of the change in the shape of the opening or the porine channel in the bacterial cell wall. So then once the antibiotic cannot get enter or into the inside the bacterial cell, so then the bacterial cell are becoming resistant to this antibiotic. Another intrinsic or natural mechanism of antibiotic resistance is, we call it an antibiotic inactivation. How bacteria inactivate antibiotic? Bacteria inactivate antibiotic by producing enzymes that destroy antibiotic or prevent the binding to the target site. So what you see here in this diagram, this is the antibiotic in green color. This is antibiotic, okay? This is the bacterial cell wall. This is the prions or the opening in the or the channels in the bacterial cell wall. This is the prion. Okay. So then what will happen is the bacteria will produce enzyme. So this is an enzyme. I'm putting a red circle around. This is an enzyme. You can see it here in purple color. So the bacteria will produce enzyme, and this enzyme will destroy the antibiotic. The enzyme will bind and destroy the antibiotic. So you can see here, this I'm using my laser pointer now. You can see the purple color enzyme binding to the green color antibiotic. And then what will happen is the enzyme, as I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, which is a purple color, destroyed the antibiotic. The enzyme destroyed the antibiotic. Or the enzyme will bind to the antibiotic, as I'm pointing out with my laser pointer. Once the enzyme will bind to the antibiotic, then this will result into the alteration in the antibiotic, and then the antibiotic cannot bind, and then this will prevent the antibiotic from performing its job in killing the bacteria or killing the bacterial cell. Now, just I want to give you an example. Remember what we said in the previous slide, that the bacteria will produce enzymes, and these enzymes will destroy the antibiotic. An example of an enzyme which is produced by the bacterial cells, and this enzyme will destroy the bacterial cell, is the beta-lactamase enzyme. What you see here in this slide, this is the chemical structure of the penicillin, okay? And then you can see what we call it here in blue color, which I'm going to get with my laser pointer. This is the beta-lactam ring. This is the beta-lactam ring in the antibiotic. The enzyme which is produced by the bacteria, we call it beta-lactamase, it will destroy this beta-lactam ring of the enzyme. And once the bacteria produce beta-lactamase, an enzyme, this beta-lactamase will attack the beta-lactam ring, which is the structure within the antibiotic, and this will result in the destruction of the antibiotic by bacterial enzyme, which is the beta-lactamase, and this will result in the activation or inactivation of the antibiotic. In the previous slide, I have talked about the role of enzymes like beta-lactamase in the activation of antibiotics that contain beta-lactam ring. What you see here in this diagram, this is the chemical structure of penicillin, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, and you can see the beta-lactam ring in red color, which is pointed at with the red arrow. So this is the beta-lactam ring in the penicillin. Under the influence of the beta-lactamase, as I'm pointing at it with my laser pointer, as I mentioned, beta-lactamase is an enzyme which is produced by the bacteria. So beta-lactamase, which is produced by the bacteria, will hydrolyze the beta-lactam ring. So you see here, so this is the penicillin, and this is the beta-lactam ring, which I'm going to get with my laser pointer. Under the influence of the beta-lactamase enzyme, you can see the disappearance of the beta-lactam ring, as I'm pointing out with my laser pointer in the penicillin. So this will result in the inactivation of the penicillin as an antibiotic. Another example, which I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, we have another antibiotic, which is cephalosporin. Cephalosporin as well, it has a beta-lactam ring, which I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, and you can see the beta-lactam ring, which is appear in red color, and you can see the square of the beta-lactam ring, and it's pointing out with this red arrow. So this is the chemical structure of the cephalosporin, and then the cephalosporin, when it gets exposed to the beta-lactamase enzyme, which is produced by the bacteria, the beta-lactamase will cause the hydrolysis of the beta-lactam ring, and this is the results, I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, this is the result will be inactive Cephalosporin inactive, cephalosporin, and you can see that the beta lactamase removed or hydrolyzed the beta lactam ring and result in the inactive cephalosporin antibiotic. As I have explained previously, that the one of the intrinsic or natural mechanism of antibiotic resistant by bacterial cells is the alteration of the target site for the antibiotic by the bacterial cell. And I'm giving you an example of the alteration of the target site for antibiotic, which is the mode of action of vancomycin. So let's look at the firstly at the mode of action of vancomycin. You can see here, as I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, we have the NAG in bright green color, which I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, and we have the NAM in dark green color. And then we have, you see, the pentapeptide, which I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, penta or five peptides attached to the NAM. So we have the pentapeptides, these ones. You see them here? Attached to the NAM. This is the NAM. Okay? And then we have in yellow color we have the pentaglycine. Remember? This is the pentaglycine, which is very important for the cross-linking. You see, this is the pentaglycine I have drawn in yellow color. I have drawn the red circle around it. What you have here in blue color, this is the vancomycin antibiotic. Vancomycin antibiotic. Now, if the bacterial cell is sensitive to vancomycin, it means that bacterial cell is not resistant to vancomycin. So then what will happen is the vancomycin in blue color, you see it here? The vancomycin in blue color, I'm putting out with my laser pointer, will come and bind to the alanine residue. You see here? You see the vancomycin in yellow color is binding to the two red ball. You see them here, which we call them alanine residue and blue. You see these ones? So what will happen is, as I mentioned, the vancomycin in blue color, as I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, will bind to the two red ball, which is the alanine residue. You see them here? As I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, this is the alanine, L or D. So then, vancomycin in blue color binding to the alanine residue. Okay? So then what will happen? Once the vancomycin as an antibiotic will bind to the alanine residue, as I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, then when the enzyme, which is we call it transpeptidase, which is similar to the penicillin binding protein, then the function of transpeptidase is the cross-linking of the pentapeptides. However, because of the vancomycin in blue color is already bound to the alanine, so as you see here in the diagram, the transpeptidase, which as I mentioned, it has a similar mode of similar action like the penicillin binding protein, this transpeptidase cannot bind to the alanine. Okay, so then the transpeptidase cannot cross-link the pentapeptides, and this will result in the deassociation of the two layers or strands of the peptidoglycan, as you see it here. You see it here in this diagram? You see it here, which I'm pointing out with my laser pointer. The first strand, you see it here, which I'm pointing out with my laser pointer. And the second one, they cannot cross-link. So this will lead to the damage of the bacterial cell wall and the death of the bacterial cell wall due to the action of the vancomycin. Okay. However, if the bacteria is resistant to the vancomycin, as I'm pointing out with my laser pointer. You see, this is the case when the bacteria is resistant to vancomycin. So then what will happen is As I mentioned previously, alteration of the target site. The target site for vancomycin was alanine residuous in the pentapeptide. Okay? You see here the vancomycin in the blue color bound to the alanine. So then what will happen is, if the bacteria is becoming resistant to the vancomycin, the bacteria will change the alanine into D-lactate. You see it here? The alanine changed into D-lactate. Okay. So you see it here? This is from red ball. It will become as a square purple color. So the normal shape of the D-alanine, as I mentioned, is like red ball, like this one. This is the D-alanine, this one. You see it here? This is the D-alanine. However, when it will become, it will change to D-lactate. You see it here? This is the D-lactate. You see it here? So the alanine changed to D-lactate. It will become a purple square. You see it here? I'm drawing blue circle around it. You see it here? You see it here? Now it's a red circle. So this is the alanine become D-lactate. So there is a change in the target site. A change from alanine into D-lactate. You see it here, the D-lactate? This one. So then what will happen is, the vancomycin, when it will come, usually vancomycin will bind to what? It will bind to alanine. But because alanine is changed into D-lactate, so then vancomycin cannot bind to it. Then the vancomycin cannot bind to D-lactate. Vancomycin can bind only to alanine. See, this is alanine. Vancomycin can bind to alanine. It cannot bind to D-lactate. So then what will happen is, it means that vancomycin will have no effect on these bacterial cells. Why? Because alanine has been changed to D-lactate. So then vancomycin cannot bind to it. So then what will happen is, then the transpeptidase, which is this one, will cross-link the pentapeptides. This is one pentapeptide, and this is the other one, through the pentaglycine in yellow color, which is this one. Through the pentaglycine in yellow color. You see the pentaglycine? I'm going to get with my laser pointer. This is the pentaglycine in yellow color. So then what will happen is, then the bacteria will have cross-linking and the bacteria will be healthy and the vancomycin could not harm or do any damage to the bacterial cells. However, if the bacteria, as I mentioned previously, is vancomycin sensitive, as I'm pointing with my laser pointer, vancomycin will bind to the alanine residuals, as I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, then the transpeptidase, which is similar in its action like the penicillin binding protein which I have described previously, then the transpeptidase cannot cross-link the pentaglycine, and then the bacteria cannot complete its cell wall synthesis, and this will result in the deassociation or the damage of the bacterial cell wall as I'm pointing out with my laser pointer. So you can see the separation. There is no cross-linking between the pentaglycine as I'm pointing out with my laser pointer. So this will result in the break in the peptidoglycan layer, and this will result in the death of the bacterial cell. And this is in the when the bacteria is sensitive to vancomycin. However, if there is alteration of the target site for the antibiotic, and in this case, alteration what happened where of the target site? The target site in this case was the alanine. The target site was alanine. So the alanine changed into D-lactate. So then vancomycin cannot bind to it. Then transpeptidase came, as I'm going to add with my laser pointer, and cross-linked the pentapeptides through the pentaglycine, which is in yellow color, and then we have intact peptidoglycan, as I'm going to add with my laser pointer. This slide just summarizing and writing what I have described in the previous slide in regard in the alteration of the target site for antibiotic, and I have explained it in the previous slide, which is the mode of action or the mechanism of action of vancomycin as an antibiotic. As I have explained to you in a previous slide regarding the mode of action of penicillin as an antibiotic, what I have stated previously, that we have the penicillin binding protein, which you see it here in this diagram, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer in a gray color. So this gray color shape is the penicillin binding protein. This penicillin binding protein, it contains a reactive serine or active site. It contains a reactive serine or active site, which I'm drawing now a green circle around it. So I'm drawing a green circle around the reactive serine, which you see it here. So this is the reactive serine, which you see it in purple color. So this is the reactive serine. For clarification, I'm using a yellow pen. You see, this is the reactive serine in purple color inside the yellow circle which I have drawn. So this is the reactive serine. Then what I have said is that the penicillin binding protein, or to be more precise, the penicillin binding protein will cause a cross, or responsible for causing a cross linking between the pentapeptides of one chain or strand of the peptidoglycan. So this is strand one, and this is the second strand, strand two, as you see here in the second step. So this is what happened in the second step. Penicillin binding protein, as I'm showing you now, or I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. So this is penicillin binding protein in gray color, will cause a cross linking between the second alanine in the pentapeptide in strand one with the another pentapeptide or L-lysine in the pentapeptide of the second strand or strand two, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. These two strands are peptidoglycan chain strands. The cross-linking, as I have described previously, between the pentapeptide in strand number one, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, with the peptidoglycan of the second strand, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, are occurring by a pentaglycine cross-linking, which you see it in a blue color. Here, I'm drawing a yellow circle around the pentaglycine, which is responsible for the cross-linking between the second alanine in the pentapeptide of the first strand of the peptidoglycan with the L-lysine in the peptide or in the pentapeptide of the second strand of the peptidoglycan. This is the second strand, and this is the cross-linking, as I have described previously. And then what I said is that we have the antibiotic, which is penicillin. So this is penicillin. You can see it here in brown color or orange color. So this is the penicillin. And the penicillin, as I'm pointing out with my black pen, will bind, you see it here, to the reactive serine or the active site of the penicillin binding protein. So you see here the binding between penicillin in orange color, the binding between penicillin in orange color, which I'm going to get with my laser pointer, with the active serine in purple color in the penicillin binding protein in a gray color, which I'm going to get with my laser pointer. And then what will happen after that, as I have described previously, that the beta lactam ring of the penicillin will be opened. As you see, as I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, you see that the penicillin will look like number 9. You see it here? This is the structure of penicillin. I'm drawing it with my black pen. So this is penicillin. It looks like number 9. And then once the penicillin will bind to the active or reactive serine in the penicillin binding protein, then the beta lactam ring, the beta-lactam, the beta-lactam ring, as I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, you see here the opening of the beta-lactam ring, the beta-lactam ring, the opening in the penicillin, so the penicillin is in orange color, and here you can see the opening of the beta-lactam ring after the binding of the penicillin to the reactive serine. So once there is the binding, then what happens is, then the shape of the penicillin change from number 9 shape into, as you see it here, looks like number 4. Looks like this. This is after the opening of the beta-lactam ring of the penicillin. So this opening of the beta-lactam ring, then what it will do is, it will inhibit the penicillin binding protein from performing its job of the cross-linking of the cross-linking of the two pentapeptides of the two different strands, strand number 1 and strand number 2 of the peptidoglycan. So then the penicillin binding protein, because penicillin bound to the reactive serine of the penicillin binding protein, so then penicillin binding protein cannot cross link the two strands, strand number 1 and strand number 2 of the peptidoglycan. So then penicillin binding protein cannot cause the cross-linking, so there will be no cross-linking. So what that means, because there is no cross-linking as I have described previously, so then means that the two strands of the peptidoglycan will be deassociated and they cannot join together or cross-link together, and this will result in the damage of the bacterial cell wall and the death of the bacterial cell. So this is the mode of action of penicillin as I have described previously. So this is what happens in antibiotic or in penicillin sensitive bacteria. However, due to natural, intrinsic or acquired reasons, what will happen? What will happen is the shape of the penicillin binding protein will alter, as we pointing here with my laser pointer. So you see here, mechanism of antibiotic resistance, we have alteration of that target site for antibiotics. So then what will happen is, as I mentioned, in the antibiotic sensitive bacteria, the penicillin will bind to reactive serine or the active site in the penicillin binding protein. However, due to the natural or intrinsic due to the natural, intrinsic, or acquired reasons, what will happen is an alteration of the target site for the antibiotic. The alteration in this case will occur in the reactive serine, which is in purple color, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, of the penicillin binding protein. Okay? And as I'm drawing now, so then what will happen is, you see here, I'm drawing brown circle around the penicillin binding protein. And you can see this is the, like if we can use this word, the normal shape of the penicillin binding protein, and this is the in purple color we have the reactive serine. However, due to intrinsic or acquired reasons, then the shape of the penicillin binding protein and especially the reactive serine will change. So I am drawing a brown circle around the penicillin binding protein and reactive serine after it's changed its shape. So this is the normal shape of the penicillin binding protein and reactive serine, as I'm going to get with my red arrow, and this is after the alteration in the reactive serine or the active site of the penicillin binding protein. So then what will happen is, because there is an alteration in the reactive serine or in the penicillin binding protein and its reactive serine, so then what will happen is, then the penicillin, for example, as an antibiotic, it cannot bind to the alterated in reactive serine. Why? Penicillin cannot bind to the reactive serine because there is alteration in the shape of the reactive serine. Because there is an alteration in the shape of the reactive serine, so the penicillin cannot bind to it. So the penicillin cannot bind to the reactive serine or the active site of the penicillin binding protein. So what that mean? It means that the penicillin binding protein, as I'm drawing a black circle around it, you can see here, you can see the penicillin binding protein in gray color, I'm pointing it with a black arrow, will cross-link, you see here, will cross-link between the second alanine, which is this one, and the pentapeptide. You see, this is the second alanine, which I'm pointing at with my green arrow. You see, this is the second alanine. Okay? And in the first strand of the peptidoglycan, it will cross it up with the L-lysine in the second strand. This is the, as I mentioned previously, this is the second strand, and this is the first strand. So you can see the cross-linking through what? Through the beta-glycine in yellow color. This is the beta-glycine. So you can see here the occurrence, you see here the cross linking. I'm drawing a red square around it. You see the cross linking between the two pentapeptides, between second alanine with the L lysine, second alanine in the first strand of the peptidoglycan with the L-lysine in the second strand of the peptidoglycan. Okay? So it means that penicillin could not do its function of inhibiting this cross-linking. Okay? And as a result of that, so then there will be cross-linking, so then the bacterial cell wall are intact, and the penicillin cannot or could not perform its job. You see it here? No binding. Okay, you see here the penicillin cannot bind to the active site of the or reactive serine in the penicillin binding protein. So then what will happen is, in this case, because this bacteria is antibiotic resistant, so then this bacteria will be able to utilize the penicillin binding protein to create the cross-linking through the beta-glycine between the second alanine in one strand of the peptide glycan with the L-lysine in the beta-peptide of the second strand of the peptide glycan. Usually, what has been established before, that a mutation in a gene, we call it MECA gene, a mutation in this gene, it can lead to the alteration in the penicillin or alteration in the reactive site of the penicillin binding protein. Also, it has been shown that Streptococcus pneumoniae, which I'm going to get with my laser pointers, is resistant to penicillin antibiotic due to alteration in one or more of the penicillin binding protein, or PBP. And this alteration in the penicillin binding protein will make Streptococcus pneumoniae resistant to penicillin. And as I mentioned previously, alteration of the target site for antibiotic could be due to natural, intrinsic, or acquired reasons. What you see here, this is what this diagram is similar to the diagram which I have shown in the previous slide. But what I'm trying to show you here is that when there is a mutation in the MECA gene, you see it here, which I am drawing a red circle around it. So this is a mutation in MECA gene. What it will result in alteration, result in the alteration in the shape of the penicillin binding protein to A. So this one, mutation in the MECA gene, will result in the alteration of the shape of the penicillin binding protein. So the mutation in MACA gene will result in this change in the shape of the penicillin binding protein, which I'm drawing a circle around it. So this change in the shape of the penicillin binding protein due to what? Due to mutation in the MECA gene. Okay? And this, because the bacteria acquired the mutation in the MACA gene, so then penicillin cannot bind to the active site in the penicillin binding protein, and then penicillin cannot kill the bacterial cell as I have described previously. What you see here, this is the MACA gene, okay? And this MACA gene codes for the penicillin binding protein to A, which is this one. So you can see that a mutation in MACA gene resulted in the alteration, of the target site for the antibiotic. Okay? And I gave you an example, which is the penicillin binding protein. Another example is, remember we have described it previously, when in the vancomycin, in the mode of action of vancomycin, and then in the bacteria resistant to vancomycin, when I said that the D-alanine will be changed to D-lactate. And this is a good example of changing of the target site for antibiotic, as I have described previously, in the mode of action and antibiotic resistant to vancomycin. In a previous slide, we have talked about the mechanism of antibiotic resistance in a bacterial cell, and we said that we have two different mechanisms, intrinsic or natural, and acquired. And then I said acquired, it's due to genetic methods, and then the genetic methods can be divided into chromosomal methods, which will include mutations, and extra chromosomal method, which will include bacterial plasmids. Now, in the next few slides within this lecture, I'm going to talk to you more about these two chromosomal methods and the extra chromosomal methods. As I have stated previously, that for mechanisms of antibiotic resistance, we have intrinsic or natural causes of bacterial antibiotic resistance, and we have acquired mechanisms of bacterial antibiotic resistance. In regard to the acquired antibiotic resistance, as I have stated in the previous slide, we have genetic methods, and genetic methods are divided into chromosomal methods and extra chromosomal methods. Chromosomal methods and extra chromosomal, both of them are under the heading of acquired antibiotic resistance. The first chromosomal methods, which results in antibiotic resistance of a bacteria, we call it DNA mutations. By definition, DNA mutation is changes in the DNA structure, in the DNA structure of the gene. And as I gave you a previous example, that a mutation in the MECA gene, this mutation in the MECA gene in a bacterial cell will result in the alteration of the active serine of the penicillin binding protein, and this alteration in the target binding site of the antibiotic due to this MECA mutations will make the bacteria to become resistant to penicillin. I have described this point in much more details in a previous slide within this lecture. Example of acquired resistance include mycobacteria, tuberculosis, or include antibiotic resistance by mycobacterium tuberculosis, and also antibiotic resistance of mycobacterium lepra, and also methicillin resistance staphylococcus aureus, or we call it MRSA. Usually, mutant strains of bacteria, they are more resistant in comparison to the non-mutant strains or mutant strains of bacteria. So what that means, that bacteria that they have mutations in its genes, then these genes are related or making the bacteria resistant to certain antibiotics. Of course, they are more resistant and more virulent in comparison to the non-mutated bacteria, because the non-mutated bacteria are more susceptible to antibiotics. In this part of the lecture, I'm going to give you an example or examples of DNA mutations which resulted in a bacteria of becoming resistant to certain types of antibiotics. For example, the bacterial protein, we call it GYRA. This GYRA protein is essential for maintaining the DNA structure of the bacterial cell. This GYRA protein is targeted by antibiotic, we call it fluoroquinolone. This antibiotic, which is fluoroquinolone, block the DNA binding part of the GYRA protein. So what that means? It means that after the fluoroquinolone block the DNA binding part of the GYRA protein, It means that the GYRA protein can no longer carry out its function. So what that means? It means that the bacteria will become resistant to fluoroquinoline. Why? By acquiring a mutation in the gene that codes for the GYRA protein. And because of a mutation in the gene that codes for the GYRA protein, it means that the GYRA protein cannot conduct its function for maintaining the DNA structure of the bacterial cells, and this means that the bacteria are becoming resistant to fluoroquinoline. Another example, which for another antibiotic, we call it daptomycin. This antibiotic daptomycin required the presence of calcium. Why? Because this antibiotic need calcium for its binding. So the mutation in the gene, which we call it MPRF gene, will result in the change of the charge of the cell membrane surface to positive. This means that it will be inhibiting the binding of calcium, and it will inhibit the action of the daptomycin, and then the bacteria will become resistant to daptomycin. So you can see here that mutations in two different genes will result in the bacteria becoming resistant to two different antibiotics. The first example, a mutation in the GYRA gene, which codes for the GYRA protein, made the bacteria to be resistant to fluoroquinoline antibiotic. Another example, a mutation in the gene, we call it MPRF gene, made the bacteria resistant to an antibiotic, we call it daptomycin. Another approach of acquired antibiotic resistance of bacteria is what we call it the extrachromosomal method. And extrachromosomal method will involve, or methods will involve, the bacterial plasmid. Plasmid, as I mentioned previously, is an extrachromosomal genetic element that can replicate independently and freely within the bacterial cytoplasms. Plasmid or bacterial plasmid, it carries what we call them gene resistant or resistant gene, or R genes. R is an abbreviation of antibiotic resistance. Sometimes we call it R plasmid. So the plasmid which carries antibiotic resistant genes, we call it resistant plasmid or R plasmids. As I mentioned previously in the bacterial genetics lecture, that the R genes or resistant genes can be transferred from one plasmid into another plasmid or into the bacterial chromosome. And most or many of the emerging of the antibiotic resistance bacteria are attributed to the bacterial plasmid. So bacterial plasmid is responsible for the resistance of bacteria into many different types of antibiotics. We're still talking about acquired mechanism of antibiotic resistance, and an important element of the acquired mechanisms of antibiotic resistance is gene transfer, and I have described gene transfer in detail in my previous lectures in bacterial genetics. And here we are talking about the transfer of R genes or resistant genes, which is responsible for antibiotic resistance from one bacterial cells to another cells. And as I have mentioned previously, that antibiotic resistant genes can be transmitted from one bacterial cell into another through conjugation, transduction, transformation, or by integrons or by transposons. And I have explained, as I mentioned previously, gene transfers and how these mechanisms of gene transfer can transfer antibiotic resistant gene from one bacterial cell into another bacterial cell. Before finishing my lecture on antibiotics, I would like to bring your attention to a very important kind of resistance and a microorganism, which we call it methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus, or MRSA. Methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus, or MRSA, as an abbreviation, refers to group of gram-positive cocci that they are genetically distinct from other strains of Staphylococcus aureus. Usually, MRSA is responsible for several difficult to treat infections in human. Why it is difficult to treat infections? Because the infection with this type of Staphylococcus aureus is with a bacteria that resistant to commonly used antibiotic, and that's why make infection with this type of bacteria sometimes to be harmful to a human. Usually, Staphylococcus aureus will become methicillin resistance either through natural or intrinsic way, as I have described previously, as one of the mechanism of antibiotic resistance, or through the acquired mechanisms of antibiotic resistance, as I have described previously. And the acquired antibiotic resistance usually occur through the horizontal gene transfer. Methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus is common. You can see it commonly in hospitals, in prisons, and in nursing homes, where usually, because people, when they go to the hospital, they can have a surgery. And then MRSA will be a good, or it will find the opportunity to infect wound or to contaminate invasive devices, for example, like catheters. And usually people in the hospitals, like elderly, they have a weakened immune system, so that's why they will make them at high risk of getting infected with methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus. And also, as I mentioned previously, that these elderly people are, as they considered to be, immunocompromised, and they are at a high risk of hospital acquired infection with methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus. Usually, MRSA began as a hospital acquired infection, but now it became as a commonly acquired and also as a livestock acquired infection. So the term HA-MRSA, it means healthcare associated or hospital acquired MRSA. However, SA or MRSA, it means community associated methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus. And LA-MRSA is a shortage or an abbreviation of livestock-associated MRSA or methicillin-resistant Staphylococcus aureus. This will bring me to the end of my lecture on antibiotics. This diagram summarizes the mechanism of antibiotic resistance. As I mentioned previously, that antibiotic resistance of bacterial cells could be attributed to natural intrinsic, as I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, or it could be attributed to acquired reasons. Now, what you see here in this diagram, we have the bacterial cell wall in dark blue color, which I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, and then inside the bacterial cell wall, we have the bacterial cytoplasm, which I'm pointing at it with my laser pointer, which appear in pink color, or as a pink color. Okay, the first mechanism of antibiotic resistance in bacterial cells, as I have described previously, are due to the alteration of antibiotic binding target or targets. I gave you two previous examples within this lecture. The first example was the vancomycin, and I explained to you that in regard to vancomycin, It uses the transpeptidase, okay? And transpeptidase, as I have stated previously, a transpeptidase is a group of enzyme, and under the transpeptidase, we have the penicillin binding protein as a subgroup. So penicillin binding protein is a subgroup of the transpeptidase enzymes. And then what I said to you is that the transpeptidase are responsible for the cross-linking between the two strands of the peptidoglycan, okay, through the pentaglycine. And then I said to you, in bacteria which are resistant to vancomycin, what will happen is that the alanine in the pentapeptide, and the alanine is the target site for the vancomycin, the alanine will be converted into D-lactate. So there is an alteration in the antibiotic binding target. And this alteration from alanine to D-lactate will inhibit the vancomycin from killing the bacterial cells, as I have described in detail previously. Another example, which I gave it to you, regarding the alteration of antibiotic binding targets, was the penicillin-resistant bacteria. And what I said to you is that due to, for example, a mutation in the MECA gene, then what will happen is that there will be an alteration in the reactive serine, or the active site of the penicillin binding protein. And then as a result of that, penicillin cannot bind to the altered reactive serine, and this will result of the penicillin unable to inhibit the function of the penicillin binding protein. You can see here that the resistance in this bacteria to penicillin occurred by a changing to the target site, or the alteration of the binding site for the, or target for the antibiotic. And as a good example is the alteration in the reactive serine in the penicillin binding protein. So this is the first mechanism, alteration of antibiotic binding targets. The second one is degradation of the antibiotic. You remember, I have explained to you previously that bacteria will produce enzymes like beta-lactamase. And these enzymes, which is beta-lactamase, will hydrolyze the beta-lactam ring in antibiotic like penicillin and cephalosporin. Hydrolysis of the beta-lactam ring by enzyme like beta-lactamase will result in the inactivation of antibiotics like penicillin and cephalosporin. So then the bacteria become resistant to penicillin and to cephalosporins in another mechanism, which by producing enzymes that hydrolyze or degrade the beta-lactam ring, which is one of the components of the penicillin and cephalosporin. And as a result of that, the penicillin and cephalosporin will become inactive, and then they can, because they are inactive, so these two antibiotics cannot harm or kill the bacterial cell. Another mechanism of antibiotic resistance, which I have explained previously, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, is alteration or loss of drug entry ports, or we call them purines. You remember what we said is, I said that the antibiotic, you see it here, the purine, which you find it here, you see, I'm going to get it with my laser pointer, so you can see the purine, or the opening channel in the bacterial cell wall in yellow color. So this is the purine. I'm drawing a red circle around it, so you see the purine here. So these are the opening, or the channels. So this purine, through it, the antibiotic will go into the inside the bacterial cell. Okay? However, due to natural intrinsic or acquired reasons, then what will happen? There will be an alteration in the shape of these opening or the purine channels. And because there is an alteration in the shape of these purine channels or this opening in the bacterial cell wall, then the antibiotic is not going to be able to enter this purine. Why? Because the shape of this purine or opening are changed. Another mechanism of antibiotic resistant in bacteria is what we call it increased expression of a flux pump, which I'm drawing a circle around. So what will happen in this case? In this case, the antibiotic will enter the bacterial cell. So this is the antibiotic. You see, this is the antibiotic. I'm drawing a green circle around. So this is the antibiotic. So you can see the antibiotic already entered the bacterial cell. So the antibiotic, they are inside the cytoplasm of the bacterial cell. Okay, so this is the antibiotic inside the bacterial cell. And then what will happen is the bacterial cells will have a device. The bacterial cell will have a device. This device is like a pump. It will kick or push the antibiotic outside the bacterial cell. So you see here, this is the antibiotic. I'm drawing a red circle around it. And then you can see, if you follow the black arrow, you can see that a flux pump will be pushing the antibiotic outside the bacterial cell, as I'm pointing with my red pen and red arrow. So you can see here, these antibiotics are kicked out from the cytoplasm of the bacterial cell by using what we call them a flux pumps. So this is a different mechanism of antibiotic resistance in bacterial cell. This slide summarizes what I have stated in the previous slide and in the previous diagram regarding the different mechanisms of antibiotic resistance in bacteria. And as you can see here, the first mechanism is decreased uptake of antibiotic by bacterial cell. Second one is the antibiotic efflux, or the efflux pump, which, as I mentioned previously, will push the antibiotic outside the bacterial cells. The third one is the alteration of the target site, and I give you many examples. For example, like the alteration in the active serine of the penicillin binding protein, and this will make the bacterial cells to be resistant to penicillin. Then the fourth one, acquisition of the ability to destroy or modify an antibiotic, and give you an example with bacteria that produces beta-lactamase enzyme, and this enzyme will destroy the beta-lactam ring of antibiotic like penicillin or cephalosporin, and this will make the antibiotic like penicillin or cephalosporin inactive, and then they cannot kill the bacteria, and which means that the bacteria are becoming resistant to penicillin and cephalosporin. This slide will end our lecture on antibiotic. This will bring me to the end of today's lecture on the mechanisms of antibiotic resistance in bacterial pathogens. At the end of this lecture, please don't forget to share this lecture with your friend and colleagues in order to obtain the rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thank you.